Hey everyone, I'm Sam from Prismic. Today I'm here with Delba from Vercel, and today Delba is going to tell us about what's new at Next.js, because Vercel are the creators of Next.js,
yeah.
And just last month, or a little longer, but in October, Vercel hosted NextConf and announced some cool new things. So what's going on?
So I thought today we could talk about middleware and edge functions.
Okay.
And also about our new Next.js compiler, which is built with Rust.
This is very good because you said edge functions, a Rust compiler, and middleware, and I only have very fuzzy ideas of what any of these things are. So I'm hoping we can also kind of like explain to people what they are and why they're exciting a little bit.
Yeah.
So let's break that down. Edge functions. I'm a JavaScript developer, so I know what a function is, but I've never heard the keyword edge in JavaScript. So what does that mean?
Yeah. So the edge is, it's not such a new concept. It's been around for a while. But as developers, we haven't really, especially as React developers, we haven't really been making much use of it. So the way that I like to think about the edge is that you have your origin service where you deploy your code to.
Your origin server is just what we think of as just your server.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly, your server. So it could be a region. So when you deploy to a cloud hosting platform, you may be asked to pick a region or multiple regions to host your code.
Yeah, US East or something.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So, or London or wherever your region is. Now, when you render your application on a server, you have to send a request to that server and then back. And there are some downsides to, you know, server-side rendering and running code on the server, such as latency.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this does blow my mind, because when you choose that US East server, it's crazy to think that every time you click save or deploy, you have that information going all the way across the Atlantic Ocean, because we're here in Paris right now.
Exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. So whenever a user visits your website and makes a request, that information has to go to the server and then back.
Mm-hmm. And there is some latency there.
There is some latency. Now, what we were able to introduce with Next.js was static site generation. So what that means is you can build your website or render it when you deploy it, and then you can cache the result in CDNs across the world, which means that your users can quickly receive that content because the location of the CDN is closer to your user compared to the origin server. So
with static site generation, you're generating every single page of your website. It's there. It's ready to go. It's like a pizza that's just sitting waiting for, you know, you to come in and buy it and take it out of the store.
Exactly.
And then you're also putting it on CDNs, so it's on a server close to the user wherever they are around the world, in Asia or Europe.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Okay.
So that makes content delivery fast, but the downside of that is that we lose the ability to make our content dynamic, because we up to this point, we weren't running code, you know, at these CDN edges. So what the edge enabled us to do is not just, you know, cache or store our content, but we can also run code closer to our users, so that when a user makes a request, the request isn't sometimes not going all the way to the origin server, but it's going to the edge and then back. I like to think about the edge in terms of distribution. So what you're doing is you're writing logic that is copied and then distributed across all the edge locations, so that when a user makes a request, you can run code closer to them.
So the code is closer to the user. So to make sure that I understand what that means, until now, the CDN geographically distributes our static assets. So that's like your static site generation. So you've got static web pages stored on a CDN around the world, so they're easy to access.
Yeah.
What edge functions are doing is it's not just static anymore. You are actually storing functions that can run on servers around the world.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Really cool.
Yeah. So what that allows us to do is we can move some of the computational work either from the client side or the server side to the edge. So that we take the burden from the client, and also we make it faster by not having to, you know, just one origin that the request has to go to by placing it in multiple locations.
So do you have an example of a kind of function that might be useful to put on the edge?
Yeah, so for example, you might be familiar with middleware, and we use it in things like Express. So middleware is something that you place between two things. So in this case, we're placing middleware at the edge between as edge functions between the user's request and the server. So middleware runs before that request is completed.
Okay.
With middleware, you could do things like checking if a user is logged in or authentication. Typically, you would handle this, you know, with your backend on your server. But now, one of the things that you can do with the edge is handle that logic at the edge, so that if a user were to log in, or if you want to check if a user is logged in, you don't have to complete the whole, you know, trip. You can just quickly deliver that content back to the user based on whether they're logged in or not.
So an example might be if a user comes to your homepage and there's a delay before their avatar appears in the top right corner, or their user profile information appears, that delay will be a lot shorter with edge functions because it doesn't have to go all the way to US East or wherever your origin server is.
Exactly.
Okay.
And one of the great things about edge functions as well is that they're a lot smaller than, you know, your typical serverless functions. So they run on V8, which is a runtime that is doesn't have all the things that a Node runtime would have. So Node has a lot of modules that we don't always use. Like, for example, you might use FS to check your file system or things like that. So if you're only checking if a user is logged in, you're going to have to boot up your Node runtime and over-provision a lot of things just to do a very small task. But with edge functions, because they have a lot smaller runtime, and it makes them fast and efficient. And this is why we're able to place these edge functions around the world in the edge network instead of having it in one single region.
So what you're saying is that you don't actually need all of Node for most of your server-side functions. So you can actually offer a Node is a runtime, but you can actually offer a smaller JavaScript runtime for these edge functions.
Yes, for these edge functions. And you can still have certain things, like, for example, the Fetch API. You can still have it in the smaller runtime.
Wow, so cool. So what else? Did Next.js announce any other new features or innovations that we want to know about?
Yeah. The new one is the Next.js compiler, which is built on Rust with SWC.
Okay.
So
a compiler built on Rust with SWC.
Yes, that's a big one.
Okay. Rust, this is confusing because Rust is a programming language, which is not JavaScript.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So the thing with Rust is that we began to reach limitations in terms of performance within Next.js because the tools that we were using for compiling, bundling, they were built on top of JavaScript. Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily know the intricacies of, you know, the limitations of JavaScript, but I do know that with Rust, because it's a low-level language, we can improve our performance by rebuilding the infrastructure behind Next.js. So one of the things that the Next.js team was working on and still working on is making sure that a lot of the things that we could previously do with JavaScript, like compiling or minifying, that we can now do those things with Rust.
Okay, so the Next.js compiler is now built in Rust.
Yeah.
So I want to ask you, because I feel like for a lot of developers, the idea of a compiler is kind of fuzzy. It's just something that happens in the background. So what is a compiler and what's it responsible for?
Yeah. So I think a good way to think about it is to have a basic understanding of what happens with your code once you deploy it or once it's, you know.
I try not to think about that generally.
I mean, as a developer, I don't think you need to know much about it, but it it's good to just, I guess, just have a basic understanding. So when you compile your code, what you're doing is you're taking code that you've written, for example, in modern JavaScript with the latest tools and technologies, and then you're translating that into a code that other browsers would understand.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we talk about minifying your code, we're also talking, because the compiler can also minify your code,
mm-hmm.
We're also talking about taking your code and then removing the extra stuff that is not necessary for it to run in the same way. So like any extra spaces or, you know, words or... So by doing that, you make your code more performant because it makes it easier for, I guess, browsers to take that code and then render your application.
Mm-hmm. So basically the compiler is taking all the code, making it like usable in the browser,
mm-hmm.
and also removing any unnecessary spaces or transforming it to make it smaller in any way that it can.
Yeah, minifying it. Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Because if anybody's ever tried to run a Node program in the browser, they've seen that you run into problems.
Exactly. And that leads to performance improvements because, like, if you think about the developer experience when you are, you know, preparing your code for production or you're just, I guess, in your dev environment, saving your code and then seeing the results on screen.
Mm-hmm.
What we've noticed with the Rust compiler is that we were able to improve view times and also improve fast refresh. So that's when you're saving your mm-hmm. code and then seeing the results on screen.
So the compiler isn't something that developers do per se. It's mm-hmm. part of the experience of working with.
Yeah, exactly. It's the infrastructure of Next.js that makes it performant.
Mm-hmm. So as you're developing, like you just mm-hmm. said, when you're in dev mode, if you make a change to your code, you'll get a fast refresh in your browser much more quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And when you build your site, the build will happen much more quickly.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly.
Really cool.
Yeah. And one of the things that I really love about this compiler is that if you have a custom Babel configuration or plugin, you can opt out of it. But what the Next.js team is working on at the moment is they're collecting feedback to see why developers are deciding to opt out, to see if there's any edge cases that we haven't yet thought of. Like, for example, one of the things that I'm very excited about is testing with Jest. So Jest is a tool that we use for front-end testing. And to set up Jest to work with Next.js, you have to spend a lot of time in the documentation figuring out, you know, what Jest options to use to make sure that it works with Next.js. And we wrote some documentation around it, and we've given the developers the different options. But now, with this new Rust compiler, if developers are using the compiler instead of Babel, we can actually port that information into Next.js so that all that configuration that you need to do to set up Jest is no longer needed because it's built in within Next.js.
Okay.
So that saves a lot of time for developers because you're no longer having to, you know, set up all that configuration. So
it's taking care of a lot of the config for you.
Exactly. Right. It's taking care of a lot of the config, and there's also a lot of other exciting things that they're working on that will just make, you know, that process of setting up your tools much, much easier. Which is
amazing.
Kind of what we aim to do with Next.js is making sure that if there's any configuration that developers don't need to do because we can make those decisions for them, we will apply them to help developers.
Yeah, I mean, this is a huge and important part of web development. Generally, we often think about what it's like for the users,
mm-hmm.
but your job is to think about what the experience is like for the developers as users.
Exactly.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for the update.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really excited to try these things out. And I'm curious if anybody has any questions about these updates, if they could put them in the comments. Otherwise, next up, we're actually going to turn it around and talk about Prismic a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Delba wants to see what Slice Machine is all about. So we are going to do some programming with Slice Machine. And if you don't want to miss that, be sure to subscribe.